Technology has come a long way over the last 40 years, from CPUs becoming more affordable to powerful processors and storage we have today. Let's take a step back from all the buzz around cloud computing and AI. How do computers really work? And are they really that different from what they were 40 or even 50 years ago? Let's rewind the clock and look at an 8-bit computer and understand exactly how it works. Hello and welcome back to Evan's Retro Lane. If you've been following my channel, you would already know that I have a background in software engineering and taught it back in the early 2000s. I did get a head start though at the age of 7, thanks to the amazing manuals that came with my first computer. Check out my episode on retro user manuals and magazines to see exactly how it began for me and many others. For this first episode of the Programmer series, I thought long and hard about what I should cover. There are many topics, how to code in any of the many languages, or why not start from the beginning? I thought it would be a good idea to talk about how a computer system actually works. By that, I mean, what are the typical components needed to create a computer system, and how do we make it do what we want it to? Before we begin, I just want to say this episode will be a high-level explanation of 8-bit processors. This by no means is a university-level course. I'll be explaining programming assembly and machine language for people who might be interested and may not have a background in programming. And I'll be using a VIC-20 to demonstrate some of the topics. So with that out the way, let's get started. There is one thing that you already know, and that is that all computer systems are powered by electricity. Really old computer systems pre-1970 were designed for a specific purpose and were wired accordingly. This meant that electrical circuits were designed in a way which mimicked logic to some degree, but doing anything other than what it was intended for would be out of the question. A simple example is a kitchen toaster, a simple circuit made up of transistors, resistors, and capacitors, turns on and supplies power to the electromagnet. The electromagnet attracts the piece of metal on the handle, holding the bread in the toaster. The simple circuit acts as a timer. In the early 1970s, the microprocessor was born. This was a single integrated chip, which included data processing, arithmetic, logic, and control functions. This meant that you could use this chip to send signals to a number of components attached to it. The first microprocessor was from Intel in 1971. It was the Intel 4004 and was a 4-bit processor. A year later, Intel came out with the 8008, which was an 8-bit processor. In the mid-70s, other popular 8-bit microprocessors became available and were much more affordable. This included the famous MOS6502, which originally sold in a kit. Steve Wozniak bought one, and that is how the Apple I and II were created. The 6502 can also be found in the Commodore PET, VIC-20, 64, Atari's line of 8-bit consoles and computers, even the Nintendo Entertainment System, and many more. The Zilog Z80 was also a popular low-cost microprocessor. It can be found in the Tandy Radio Shack 80, Sinclair ZX Spectrum, ColecoVision, Amstrad CPC, Sony MSX, Sega Master System, and many more. So now that we have these microprocessors, what do we need to know in order to use them? I made an earlier point about computer systems being powered by electricity. Electricity can be in two states, on or off. And that's exactly how a microprocessor sees it as well. There is really nothing intelligent about these components because on their own, they do nothing. When we're dealing with computer data, it is in fact pulses of electricity being sent to and from components really quickly. The way in which we refer to these pulses are bits. It's not as complicated as you think. A bit is actually a bit of data, which is either on or off, or in its binary measurement, a 1 or a 0. So before I mentioned the Intel 4004 being a 4-bit processor, that means that it can process 4 bits of data in an instruction or value. 8-bit processors process 8 bits, 16-bit processors do 16 bits, and so on. The other factor behind a processor is the speed at which it executes instructions. Instructions are executed in two or more cycles. A single cycle per second is measured at 1 Hz. If a microprocessor has a clock speed of 1 MHz, that means it performs 1 million cycles per second. In the case of an early microprocessor, on its own it doesn't do much unless we connect it to additional chips that do specific things. That includes feeding it our instructions. Let's open up my favorite computer system, the Commodore VIC-20, and let's run through the typical parts you might find in a computer system. I've cleaned and heat-synced this VIC-20 computer, so it'll be hard to show you the names on top of the chips, so I'll point them out. The MOS6502 microprocessor is located here on this motherboard. As we've discussed, we need this in our computer system so that we can send it instructions to do things. The CPU is capable of understanding instructions using a bit pattern, but in order for us to feed it instructions, we need a few other components. This chip very close to the CPU is called the kernel, meaning it is core to the operation of this computer system. On our modern day computers, this is known as the basic input-output system, or BIOS. You might be thinking, that's not how you spell kernel. And you're right. Commodore called their kernel, kernel. Apparently it was a mistake in their documentation and it just stuck after that. The kernel in the VIC-20 and other Commodore computers is a chip containing input, output, system clock, and memory management routines. When we power on the computer, the kernel drives the startup process, checking whether a cartridge is inserted, testing installed RAM, setting up all the default values, displaying the startup text, then handing control over to other chips. Another important part of a computer system, while powered on, is random access memory, or RAM. RAM is temporary storage, which can be written to by the CPU while the computer is powered on. When power is lost, all data in RAM is lost.
I know nothing.
No, nothing.
No, forget that. I forget everything. I know nothing.
On this VIC-20, the RAM is found here on these two chips. The VIC-20 only has 5 kilobytes built in, but of course it can be expanded to 35 kilobytes using an expansion cartridge. Most of the time, any code executed by the CPU is stored in RAM. We simply tell it to look at a particular location and execute whatever is there. Other important chips may need to look at a particular part of RAM as well. One such chip is this one right here. This is the video interface chip, or VIC. This is the chip Commodore made this whole computer around. This chip is responsible for the audio and visual output from this computer system. The interesting thing about this chip is that it constantly looks at sections of RAM to display what we see on the screen. We'll get to this shortly when we look at displaying characters to the screen. This chip just under the VIC on this motherboard is called the character ROM. You can think of this like a built-in font. This is responsible for providing the default alphanumeric characters and symbols we see on the screen. Over here next to the kernel is the basic ROM. This provides the beginner's all-purpose symbolic instruction code programming language for use on this computer. It's based on the Microsoft flagship product, Microsoft Basic, by Bill Gates and Paul Allen. This provides additional functionality to this computer using simple English words and considered an interpreter language. It also can be slow to execute because it interprets each statement line by line at runtime. These two larger chips up here are the versatile interface adapters, which help control all the other inputs and outputs such as our joysticks, gamepads, the keyboard, the cassette port, and the serial port, and so on. Now that we're familiar with the components of a typical 8-bit computer, let's focus on understanding how instructions and data are processed. I mentioned before that an 8-bit computer can process 8 bits of data. Imagine a row of 8 blocks. These are the 8 bits we can pass to the CPU. This can either be a reference to an instruction, a value, or a memory address. Remember, we can only place a 1 or a 0 into these boxes, which behind the scenes are quick electrical pulses. Typically, when we start populating our 8-bit pattern, we do so from the right to left. I'll show you why in just a moment. Here's a question. If we have 8 boxes that can only contain a 1 or a 0, how many combinations can we have? Let's work it out. Starting with this box on the right, our first box can have either a 1 or a 0. So that's easy, we have two combinations there. Moving left across to the next square and including the previous square, we can have the following combinations: 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. That gives us four combinations. Hopefully you can see how this works. Let me do one more with you. Moving left across to the next square and including the previous squares, we can have the following combinations. That gives us eight combinations. The pattern is that for each square, the combinations double. So it's safe to assume that we can have 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, and a total of 256 combinations of ones and zeros available to us. What this means is that for an 8-bit processor, it refers to one of 256 commands or values in an instruction. Here's an example of the value 1 represented as binary, decimal, and hexadecimal. And here is the final value we can use, 255, as binary, decimal, and hexadecimal. Another thing I need to mention is that microprocessors don't start counting at 1, they actually start at 0. There isn't an easy way for a human to write a code using ones and zeros. I'm sure there are people that can, but we'll use decimal numbers instead. For each 8-bit combination, there is a decimal number associated with it. The decimal number is generally used in programming languages like BASIC. For converting binary to decimal or decimal to binary, you can always use the programmer's calculator. You can see here that each value between 0 and 255 provides an 8-bit binary code, which I'm highlighting here. If I go above 255 and enter 256, you will see that it expands to a 12-bit binary, making it impossible for an 8-bit CPU to process. Let's try it on the VIC-20 using BASIC. Let's poke a value of 255 into memory location 4096. That works fine. Now let's do the same with the value of 256. BASIC knows not to accept it and we receive an error. For the purpose of this episode and to demonstrate the use of 8-bit codes, let's look at how characters are shown on the screen. The VIC-20 screen is split up into 8x8 pixel cells. There are 22 columns and 23 rows. That gives us a total of 506 cells. Each cell is mapped to a section of RAM, known as the screen RAM. This starts at memory location 7680. The VIC chip constantly polls this section of memory and displays whatever is found in each cell. It's so simple, it's brilliant. Now you might be wondering what is stored in each memory location between 7680 and 8185. The answer is an 8-bit pointer reference to another memory location, but in this case it's the value mapped to the character ROM. On the VIC-20 and C64, you can change this to provide your own character set stored in memory if you wish. In our case here, the first cell at 7680 contains the value 42, which maps to the character ROM to display the asterisk symbol. Here is the cell zoomed in. Let's apply our 8-bit pattern to this grid. We know that each row of 8 bits corresponds to a value between 0 and 255. We simply add the number above the activated bits together to get the decimal number. The first character in the ROM is the at symbol. Here it is drawn as a pixel representation. To work out the decimal number for each 8-bit row, add the active 8-bit number shown above the column together. The maximum total for each row is 255. This is how the at character is stored in the character ROM. You can see by doing this exercise, you can design your own images using all the 8-bit cells on the screen. Here are a few examples, and that is something for another episode, but the main thing is that you understand how pixels are generated using a bit pattern. So we've just dealt with how data is represented in binary. What about the CPU's built-in instruction set to make it do things? There are a handful of functions the CPU can perform. They are very generic, but by thinking things through, we can create amazing programs. If we look back at the VIC-20 programmer's reference guide, all the instruction codes are listed in great detail. Let's look at a simple example of a CPU function. The CPU can store a value in an X, Y, and accumulator register. Let's store a number in the X register using the function LDX. Taking a look at page 153 in the programmer's reference, we see the combinations of inputs the LDX function can take. It even shows us how many CPU cycles it takes to execute. How cool is that? All we need is the first one listed, where the hash represents a hexadecimal value. Notice the opcode is A2. Let's say we want to store the value 110 in the X register of the CPU. The command in assembly language would be LDX. This loads a value into X. Hash $6E is the hexadecimal representation of 110. Going a few steps further to translate to pure machine language, LDX has the opcode A2, which we found in the book earlier. So the machine command would be A26E, which if we now convert to binary, ends up being this bit pattern. This code is stored in 2 bytes of memory. I'll cover more on basic assembly and machine languages in future episodes in this series. There we have it. We can see that while computers are great at helping us do things, they really don't do things on their own. These days, it's very easy to lose sight of the fact that this is how all computers work. On their own, they do nothing. There isn't anything intelligent about them. What is intelligent is the innovation and programming abilities of humans who create these technologies and the software layers that run on them. If you're a first-time programmer or someone who is curious about how computers work, I hope this episode answered some of your questions. I thought that this was the perfect topic to start off with. I'll continue building on this in future episodes. Give me a thumbs up or leave a comment if you've learned something and enjoyed my explanations in this video. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't already, and if you're interested in providing support, check the links in the description below. As always, thanks for watching.